Moore and Liza Minnelli facing bankruptcy in Arthur 2 on the Rocks. Eddie Murphy is an African prince who's coming to America. And number 5 tackles the big city in Short Circuit 2. It's all coming up next on Siskel and Ebert.
Every day is like Christmas morning.
Dudley Moore plays Arthur, a man trying to drink his way through $750 million in Arthur 2 on the Rocks. It's one of 5 new summer movies we're going to be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first movie is the sequel, Arthur 2 on the Rocks, picking up the drunken near-billionaire Arthur and his wife, the former waitress played by Liza Minnelli, now facing a new problem. Arthur has been rendered penniless after the father of the woman he was supposed to marry carries out a financial vendetta against him, and that means that Arthur, still a drunk, has to go looking for work.
Last job held, millionaire playboy?
Right.
Exactly what did that entail?
Well, I raced cars, I bred horses, I yachted, the usual.
Mr. Bach, this is a hardware store.
Not only is work a problem, but so is finding a home.
Yes. I'm Linda Bach, and this is my husband, Arthur.
Yeah, she'll be doing...
Speak up, honey.
She'll be doing all the talking. I can't be trusted.
Darielle!
Right.
Nothing special there. The movie comes alive only when the ghost of Arthur's crusty old butler, Hobson, played by John Gielgud, pays Arthur a surprise visit, offering advice.
You can't imagine how proud I've been watching you rooting through garbage cans, searching out discarded McNugget boxes.
Oh, you saw that?
Yes. If projectile vomiting ever becomes an Olympic event, you'll do your country proud.
The exchanges between Arthur and Hobson were the best part of the original 1981 film, and they are also the best part of this sequel. The problem is that Gielgud is on screen for somewhere between 5 and 10 minutes. It's just a cameo role, and so the comedic tension between these two characters is what is sorely missing in this sequel. Dudley Moore is fine in his character, but Liza Minnelli seems to be simply going through her paces, offering nothing distinctive. The result is the comedic predicament of Arthur losing his money is not that funny, and his battle with alcohol is handled too gently. In sum, an unsatisfying sequel.
Well, I disagree with you that it's an unsatisfying film, but I kind of have a different angle on the performances. I thought Liza Minnelli was just fine. I thought that although Dudley Moore was just fine, they did the wrong thing with his character by allowing him to have even the slightest shred of self-understanding. Mm-hmm. The first movie, in which he was drunk the entire time, right, was funny because he was kind of like Wile E. Coyote in the Roadrunner pictures. He kept running, he didn't know there was nothing underneath him. The mistake they make in the screenplay of this movie is he looks down and he sees that he's got a problem. He's going to lose his wife, he's going to lose his adopted child, he's going to lose his fortune, he's going to lose everything unless he gets responsible for his own life. Yeah. Now, that might be the thing that Arthur should do in real life, but in a comedy, it's fatal.
Well, I think what happens is those are all predictable storylines for, let's say, if you had a TV show, mm-hmm, and now what are we going to do with Arthur? Mm-hmm. But I still come back to the central flaw for me, which is it was Gielgud who brought Arthur up short, who made us really laugh in the first film, and he's just not here.
So, two thumbs down.
Right.
Okay, next movie. And our next movie is another sequel. A sequel this time to a 1986 film that did fine at the box office, but then went on to become one of the all-time leaders in video rentals. The movie was Short Circuit, the story of an intelligent and very likable robot named Number 5. And in Short Circuit Number 2, Number 5 has left the military after, remember, in the first film he got struck by lightning and became too human. So now he gets himself involved with a couple of street peddlers who are trying to market a miniature version of the robot as a toy. The robot, now named Johnny Five, is as charming as before, but a little more street smart, and he can even get a taxi cab in the big city.
Guys, you can't even get a cab in the city.
Welcome
Well, mi amiga. Oh, did I startle you?
What is that?
What is what?
That!
There are 2,312 taxi cabs in this city. And there's one now. Hey, taxi cab.
The movie uses the robot to work in a lot of social satire, as in this scene where Johnny Five repeats some of the input he's learned from television.
Yeah, we work for the Department of Car Stereo Repair, right?
Yeah, man, and we're really overworked. We got too many cars to do today. See all those cars?
Yeah.
We got to do all those cars, and we don't even get to go home to see our families and little babies and stuff.
Oh. I got radios, I got stereos, I got tape decks and CDs. Everything you need for car sound systems at low, low prices.
The movie turns into a thriller when diamond thieves become convinced Johnny Five stands between them and a big heist.
Masks? Disguises? Excuse me, gentlemen, our showroom closes at 6. Hey, ow!
Let's get that crap in.
Have a seat, gentlemen.
When the original Short Circuit came out, it looked suspiciously inspired by E.T. with the same central gimmick of a cute and clever little creature absorbed American culture while also sort of misunderstanding it and satirizing it. You had to give Short Circuit credit, though, for at least creating an entertaining creature, a mechanical toy that had a great personality. And this time, I also enjoyed that personality and the subplot about the two fly-by-night street peddlers who got the bright idea of employing Johnny Five to manufacture his own rip-off toys. He's going to make the toys himself. Now, this is not a great movie. It's probably better, it would probably seem better the younger you are, but it is a pleasant movie and an entertaining one. I liked it without necessarily going crazy over it.
I liked it, and I was very surprised by it. I was not a big fan of the original Short Circuit. I think here is that rare sequel that's better than the original, because all they had going for themselves, I think, in the original was the creature. Well, now here they've taken the creature, and this is a very heavily worked on script. There are a lot of jokes here, especially with the Indian friend of his. There's so much dialogue in here, and a lot of it made me really laugh out loud. I thought it was very satirical, very topical, and then, of course, you get down to the crunch, which is, do you care when the creature's life is in jeopardy?
Oh, I did.
And I did. And that means the movie is working. When they're hammering that thing, the bad guys are killing that that animal, I was going to say.
Killing that
little robot. I felt bad. And that means the movie works.
Well, one of the gimmicks that I enjoyed in the film is the fact that this robot can absorb input. He calls it input. He's starving for input, just like all of us.
Yeah.
Reads a book in a second. He's sucking up everything he can get from television and cable
back out.
And radio. And then, of course, when his power begins to run down, when he has a big enough charge, he can be intelligent.
Right.
But when the power begins to run down, all he can do is repeat what he hears on television.
That's a good comment.
Coming up next, Eddie Murphy stars in Coming to America, his first romantic comedy.
I have recently been placed in charge of garbage. Do you have any that requires disposal?
Our next film is a comedy called Coming to America, starring Eddie Murphy. And one of the criticisms that has dogged his tremendously successful career is that he hasn't played a romantic leading role, preferring to be a smart aleck rather than a lover. Well, Murphy rises to that challenge in the very funny Coming to America, playing an African prince who resists his parents' attempt to force upon him a bride.
Why can't I find my own wife?
Aha! So that's it. We've gone to a great deal of trouble to select for you a very fine wife. Since the day she was born, she was taught to walk and speak and think as a queen.
But father, what if I do not love her?
Murphy convinces his parents to give him 40 days to experience life before he gets married. He heads for America, secretly hoping to pick his own wife there, and he takes along his rascal aide, Semi, nicely played by comedian Arsenio Hall.
I want a woman that's going to arouse my intellect as well as my loins.
Where will you find such a woman?
In America.
In America, Murphy decides to hide the fact that he is a prince. He seeks humble living quarters.
Now, this is the place that I was telling you about. It's real stuff. Got just one window facing a brick wall. Used to rent it to a blind man.
Damn shame what they did to that dog.
Eventually, Murphy does meet the woman of his dreams, the daughter of a fast food restaurant owner. She's impressed by his humble, compassionate qualities.
Please, let me.
No, it is not right. I should pay.
Akeem,
We should stop worrying about being poor. If I wanted a wealthy guy, I'd be with Daryl. Not you.
That was Sherry Headley as the love interest. She's beguiling, and so is Murphy, taking it easy this time, confident in himself, in his on-screen presence. For the first time, he doesn't seem nervous about filling every second with a wisecrack. He's likable, and so is this funny and very charming movie. Now, just one more thing that's very funny about the picture. Murphy, in disguise, creates a couple of very funny characters who meet the prince in his slum neighborhood. He plays a black barber and an old Jewish man in disguise who are always quarreling with their buddies.
I suppose nobody in here ever heard of Cassius Clay.
We got a point. Cassius Clay was a bad one.
Hey, I ain't saying Clay ain't bad. I'm just saying I stopped liking Cassius Clay once he changed his name to Muhammad Ali. What kind of shit is that?
Wait a second. A man has the right to change his name to whatever he wants to change it to. And if a man wants to be called Muhammad Ali, damn it, this is a free country. You should respect his wishes and call the man Muhammad Ali.
His mama named Clay. I'm going to call him Clay.
And that was Arsenio Hall, also quite funny as the bearded man. Good comic cameo material in this thoroughly satisfying movie.
Well, I was also impressed by Eddie Murphy and Arsenio Hall in terms of what they did on the screen. I thought that both of them showed an enormous range of comic ability.
Right.
What surprised me, though, Gene, was the screenplay. First of all, this plot is so old-fashioned and so hackneyed and so recycled out of 100 other fairy tales and other movies that I was waiting to see what kind of twist or spin Eddie Murphy was going to put on it, and there isn't any. And the second thing is, the energy level of the movie is so low. This is the first Eddie Murphy movie I've ever seen that can accurately be described as lethargic.
Oh, I didn't think it was...
You talk about how he's sweet and laid back.
Yes.
I don't think he's way too laid back. I wanted to see Eddie Murphy take this prince and not play him so straight and so sweet, but give him a little bit of an edge.
Well, now, I'll tell you, I think Eddie Murphy, by his very nature, can't help but give a character his edge. Mm-hmm. I think he's got energy inside him. But I think it's a romantic lead. He goes back to old-fashioned style movie making, and I thought it was perfectly handled. This is
really
just the movie that I wanted to see.
You're going to talk about the romantic lead. It really is old-fashioned, because
yes,
there was nothing new-fashioned about this relationship.
And I liked it.
And the whole idea of judging women on the basis just of their physical appearance and their external qualities.
Oh, that's sweet, the way he comes off
sweet.
And do that.
Well,
I bought the whole thing.
I think that in 1988...
Did you like the movie or not?
No.
But you like what both of the leads did in their...
They're both talented guys. Give them a screenplay.
I think they got one. They did a great job with it.
Coming up next, A Handful of Dust, a classic British love story with a bizarre and ironic twist at the end.
Did you mind when I tried to kiss you?
Really? No. Not particularly.
Named A Handful of Dust, and it's based on the famous Evelyn Waugh novel about a British aristocrat who was a very good man and his wife who was a very bad woman. She cheats on her husband in the movie with Rupert Graves, who plays Beaver, a rather ill-defined young man who doesn't have much money and specializes in being a house guest at nice places in the country like Hatton Abbey, home of the last family.
Say hello to Mr. Beaver.
How do you do?
How do you do?
This is yours.
Hello, darling. Jolly church.
Most enjoyable.
Edward Old Hunt.
Perhaps I can't afford to. Please, Mr. Beaver, don't take any notice of him.
Are you poor?
Yes, very poor.
That's Kristen Scott Thomas as Brenda, wife of Tony Lass, played by James Wilby. He is a gentle, civilized, mild-mannered gentleman who dotes on his young son. The bored Brenda Lass rather likes young Mr. Beaver, and during her next visit to London, she flirts with him.
Did you mind when I tried to kiss you?
Really? No. Not particularly.
Then why didn't you let me?
A lot to learn.
When tragedy strikes the family, Tony Last is comforted and distracted by an American visitor played by Angelica Houston.
The last thing one wants to talk about at a time like this is religion.
Some like it.
Of course. When you haven't got children yourself.
I've got two sons.
Then the film takes a decidedly odd turn as Tony's marriage ends, and he goes off half-cocked on a crazy expedition to the South American jungle, where he's eventually taken captive by an eccentric recluse played by Alec Guinness.
Until 5 years ago, there was a black man. He used to read to me every day until he died. You shall read to me when you're better.
I shall be delighted to.
Yes. You shall read to me.
And as he's done all through his career, Alec Guinness there was a chameleon. I had to ask the person sitting next to me in the screening, who is that? And they said, it's Alec Guinness. And then you can see It is. It's like that. It's been like that with him for 30 years.
I think I was that person.
Thank you very much. The great peculiarity of A Handful of Dust is that almost nothing in the first three quarters of this film prepares you for the great irony of the ending, where the scene suddenly shifts to the middle of a South American rainforest. It was the absolutely arbitrary nature of that ending that appealed to Evelyn Waugh when he wrote the novel A Handful of Dust. But perhaps he also liked the dramatic contrast between the anemic civilization of British country life and then the stark reality of the jungle. The message of this film is that no matter how decent and intelligent and civilized you are, it's still likely to do you no good.
Well, I was fascinated by the film, too. I was fascinated by the early part of the film as much as the switch at the end. Mm-hmm. To see a woman this strong,
yes,
to totally reject this man, I think he may be a little more weak-willed on screen than he was in the novel, but at any rate, to just reject this man and to go off and have this affair and to throw out a whole tradition, which is what is being thrown out by her actions, was just absolutely fascinating to me. It's played well, it's cast right, it looks right, it worked for me.
And when this novel came out, it was absolutely enormously controversial in England.
Well, it's rejecting.
Can anyone turn their back
exactly
on this house that has been in his family, actually, for
yes,
years?
That's right.
On titles, on history, yeah, on tradition, on family, just in order to have her will.
Right.
And the way that she does it is the shocking thing about the film, the cold-blooded
just, yes,
quality of that performance,
yeah,
with such a nice man, too.
Yeah. I mean, she's quite something. Coming up next, License to Drive, a comedy about that age-old problem, that 16-year-old problem, getting a license to drive a car.
Buckle up, son. It's the real world out here.
A funny film about a teenager's problems after he fails his driver's license test but still wants to drive. I don't know that any such film would top my want-to-see list, but regardless, License to Drive is not that film. It is a dim-witted, predictable movie, the stuff we associate with bad TV sitcom material. Corey Haim, the likable star of Lucas, adds nothing to his reputation here as he loses control of his grandfather's car.
Oh, we're gonna die!
Oh, man, I told you this was gonna happen!
That scene isn't the least bit funny, either as a stunt or when you consider the many tragedies involving teen driving. You can also see that in this scene where Corey Haim is taken for a ride.
Door service.
There's also a weak romance in the movie with him trying to land the most beautiful girl in the world, but mostly what we have here are runaway car jokes that are neither exciting nor funny. We also have one of the dullest collection of teenagers ever filmed, and that's quite an accomplishment for License to Drive.
I don't recommend the movie either, but I sure did like it a lot more than you did, especially the first hour. Now, I think what you're reacting to probably is the last half of the movie, which is all of the chase stuff, all of the stunts, all of the special effects, all of the weird driving and the things
they
can do with cars.
Who cares?
Who cares? In fact, I would almost make it as a rule that it is no longer possible for anything involving fast-moving cars to be funny. That's just kind of like a basic principle.
I have seen a movie, and I won't say what it is, but I have seen a movie in which they do a joke about fast-moving cars that's very good. In fact, I will tell you what the name of the movie is.
It's the
Dirty Harry movie.
The new Dirty Harry movie. Yes, I know that. But that is not a real car. So I've still got you. So I would make that as a basic rule. But apart from that, the first part of this movie, you remember we're reviewing License to Drive.
Yeah, right? I want to forget that.
I thought there were a lot of big laughs in it, especially in the scene where a driving license examiner, played by a man named James Avery, is absolutely hilarious. He gets this totally frightened kid in the car. And he takes this brimful cup of coffee and puts it up on the dashboard, and he says, I don't like to get that coffee spilled on my pants, he tells the kid, you know, and here the kid is going over bumps and so forth, and the coffee's going. Now, that was a hilarious scene. And there were some other scenes in the first part of the movie that were very funny. Then I agree with you, it went to pot.
Well, I'm glad you liked the cup of coffee. Next time you look at that film, and there will never be another next time because you really didn't like the movie.
I'm not giving it thumbs up.
There's a continuity error in the amount of coffee in the guy's cup. You'll see that there's more coffee after he's drunk some a little later on, or some is spilled out. So even the scene that you like, even the scene you like.
And that spoiled the joke for you.
Roger, nothing would have made this movie work for me at that point. I think the whole movie stunk.
You're too harsh, Gene. You're much too harsh.
I know.
You're too harsh.
I know.
Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs down for Arthur II on the Rocks, with Dudley Moore and Liza Minnelli trapped in a disappointing sequel. But two somewhat surprised thumbs up for another sequel, Short Circuit 2, which Gene thought was even better than the original. A split decision on Coming to America, Eddie Murphy's new romantic comedy. Gene liked the acting by Eddie Murphy and Arsenio Hall. I did too, but I thought the script was a lethargic retread. Two thumbs up for A Handful of Dust, a British drama about a very good aristocrat and his very bad wife. And finally, two thumbs down for License to Drive, the teenage driving comedy that Gene liked even less than I did, because I found a redeeming facet, and all you could spot was whether the coffee was at the right level in the cup.
I didn't like the whole film. Coming to America is a picture that I enjoyed the most, along with A Handful of Dust and Short Circuit 2. I'm really surprised by that little Short Circuit 2. That was cute.
Okay, that's it for this week. Next time we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Clint Eastwood and The Deadpool, the latest Dirty Harry thriller.
Are you threatening me?
You want to play the game. You better know the rules, love.
And Die Hard with Bruce Willis, also playing a cop, this one trying to save some hostages who are trapped in a high rise. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
Raisinets and Goobers are playing everywhere, starring plump, juicy raisins and great golden peanuts. Both now feature creamy Nestle milk chocolate. New Checkup Gingival toothpaste, clinically proven to help reduce gingivitis, the early stage of gum disease. Sony videotapes. For taping your favorite movies, trust Sony Dynamicron ES. Whatever your videotape needs, there's only one name to play back, Sony. Tap and SureCook Space Saver Microwave is perfect for kitchens where space is at a premium. Tap and Touch solid state controls, automatic temperature probe, and wood grain decor. Furnished by Tappan.